This video shows how you can analyze a gauge R&R study using the methodology we call evaluating the measurement system. Suppose one of your critical to customer measurements is the thickness of your product, and you want to determine how much of your variation that you're seeing in the product process output is actually due to the way you measure the thickness. So you decide to do a gauge R&R study. To perform the gauge R&R analysis, you decide you're going to use three operators, and for the parts in the process, you decide you're going to use five parts, and you randomly select five parts from your process to use. Maybe you select one part a day for 5 days, and then each of the three operators is going to measure each part two times. So to begin to do the gauge R&R analysis, we need to input the data into an Excel spreadsheet. And to do that, we go to the SPC for Excel Ruin, and you're going to select MSA for Measurement Systems Analysis. And you're going to come up and you're going to select Setup Gage R&R Template and Crossed Gage R&R, which is a classical Gage R&R. You select OK, and it comes up and asks you the number of operators. We're going to use 3. The number of parts, we're going to use 5. And the number of trials, 2. And we need to include a title for it. We'll just call it Thickness. And select OK. And the program generates a template for you to enter your data. Now we're ready to enter the results into the template. We have three operators, and so we simply enter their names here. We'll just call them operator A, operator B, operator C. And then down here is where we're going to enter the results from where the operators ran each part. The parts are listed here, parts 1 through 5, and each trial, 1 and 2 for operator A, 1 and 2 for operator B, 1 and 2 for operator C. So I already have the data entered over here. I'm just going to copy it to save a little time over here, and we'll put it into here. And this is a pretty good way of taking a quick look at what some of the results, because what you'll see here in this layout is for operator A, here's his two trials, part 1, 67 and 62, and you can see there's a difference of 5 there. And here's a difference between part 2 for operator A all the way across. So this is a good way of kind of looking at the data quickly to see if there's anything that jumps out at you. In a few minutes, we'll be talking about analyzing the results using an X-bar and R-chart as one of the techniques, and we'll be forming subgroups based on each operator and part combination. So one subgroup will be operator A when he ran part 1. It'll be the two trials. That'll be a subgroup. We'll be calculating the average of the subgroup, so the average of 67 and 62 for the X-bar chart, and then taking a look at the range. In this case, the range for this is 5. We'll be comparing that for all the operator part combinations. Now up here you can enter some information about dates. Enter the date that you're doing the study. You can enter the gauge name, and we'll just call it my gauge, gauge number, gauge type, thickness, and product, and we'll just call it our part. And the characteristic is the thickness as well. Now the process average and process sigma can be entered, and we'll talk about those in a minute. I'm going to go ahead and enter the specifications. Suppose our upper specification is 120 and our lower spec is 40, and it's performed by Bill. Now we're ready to run the analysis. To do that, we simply go back to our SPC for Excel menu, go to MSA for Measurement Systems Analysis, and we're going to select Analyze Gage R&R, and this time we're going to do the EMP method. And we select OK, and the software generates the results. It adds three new sheets to your workbook: a summary page, which we'll talk about, the analysis of main effects and mean range chart, and the X-bar and R charts. And what we're going to start with is the X-bar and R chart. We'll start by taking a look at the X-bar and R charts as well as the analysis of main effects charts. Remember what we said we were going to do with the X-bar and R-charts. We were going to take a subgroup formed of each combination of operator part number and plot the average of that subgroup on the X-bar chart and the range of the subgroup on the R-chart. And so for our first result, for operator A, he had a 67 for his first trial with part 1 and a 62 for the second trial. So what we do is take the average of those, and that's 64.5, and we plot that on the X-bar chart. And the range is down here, 5, and we plot that on the range chart. And we do that for all combinations. So here's operator B, part 1, all the way over to operator C, part 5, both on the X-bar and on the R-chart. So we plot the results, and we calculate our averages and our control limits using the classical calculations for the control limits on X-bar and R-charts. With the range chart, you're looking to ensure that all the ranges are the consistent. Each range we have is a measure of the repeatability for that operator. And if there are no points beyond the upper control limit, then you can say that the range chart is in statistical control. And you can conclude that the repeatability of each operator is the same. And if there are any values above the upper control limit, then you need to find out why. You need to find out what caused that out of control point, because there's a special cause of variation present, and it's going to impact the results. In this chart, you can see that there are no points above the upper control limit, so that means the test retest, or the repeatability for each of these operators, is essentially the same. And you can take the average range there to actually go ahead and estimate what that repeatability variance is for calculations later. All these calculations are shown in detail in our help files, as well as on our website in our SPC knowledge base. You can confirm your conclusions about the ranges being the same by constructing what is called a mean range chart. And to do this, what you do is you calculate the average range for each of the operators. So of those five parts that operator A tested, he had an average range of 5.6, operator B 3.8, and operator C 3.4. And you plot those and you calculate an average. Then you add what we call control limits. And these are not really classical control limits or such, because they're based on scaling factors that depend on subgroup size, etc. But they serve the same purpose as control limits. And what you're looking for here is to see if there are any points beyond the upper control limit or the lower control limit. And you can see in this case these three ranges are within these control limits, which imply that each of the operators have the same repeatability or the same test retest error. Now let's move to the X-bar chart. What does this X-bar chart tell you? What you're looking for here is to see if the operators appear to have the same results for each of the parts. Now remember, the control limits on an X-bar and R chart are based on the average range. And the average range down here is a measure of the repeatability or the test-retest error of the measurement system. And hopefully that is small. So if that average range is small, these control limits should be tight, and most of the points should be out of control. So the more points that are out of control on this X-bar chart, the better it is for your measurement system. And you can see most of our points are out of control. Now the other thing that you're looking for here is to see if the operators have similar results for each of the parts. So operator A is here, operator B here, operator C here, and it appears that operator A tends to have a little higher results than perhaps operators B and C. So our conclusion might be at this point is that operator A is a little different than operators B and C. We can confirm our suspicions about the operator A having different averages than operator B and C, that is, that bias exists, by doing something that's called the main effects chart. And what we do here is we calculate an average for operator A, operator B, and operator C, and operator A's average is 81, operator B 72.5, operator C is in here hiding behind this control limit, but it's 73.9. And what you do then is you calculate an average. Then again, you calculate some control limits. Again, these are based on scaling factors. They're not identical to control limits, but they serve the same purpose. And you can see that operator A is above the upper control limit, and operator B is below the lower control limit. But you take a look at the results, and you can see that it appears from this that B and C are very close, and operator A has a different average result. So that means that there's bias in the test method, and we need to find out what happens, because it's going to increase the amount of variation that's due to our measurement system. Now we'll move on to the EMP summary worksheet, which really summarizes the results in quite a bit of detail. It starts simply by putting the name of our Gage R&R study up in the top, and then it has the information that we had entered into the template. It gives you the number of operators, number of parts, number of trials, and it gives you the operator names. Then it comes down, it's going to give you the X bar and R chart results, which we've looked at already. We said there were 11 out of 15 points are out of control, and the larger the number of out of control points, the better it is. And the R chart, and there are no out of control points on the R chart, which means just the ranges are consistent. Then it gives you the basic results from the analysis of mean effects chart and the analysis of mean range chart, which we took a look at. There's evidence of detectable bias between the operators. We saw that because operator A had that higher average. And then there's no differences in the test-retest error between the operators or the repeatability of the operators, and because we saw that also. So this top part summarizes what we have already seen from the X-bar and R charts and the mean effects charts and the mean range chart. Now we'll move on to the variance components table. And what this table does is it lists the component, the variance for that component, and the percent of total variance due to that component. So the first one is repeatability. And repeatability we get from our R chart back here. From this average range is used to calculate that repeatability. And the result was 14.3. The reproducibility is based on those range of the average for each of the operators, which we had from over here in the main effects table, and it is 18.457, and our combined gauge R&R is simply the sum of these two. Then we've calculated our product from the average of the parts, and we calculated our total variance as well. So you can go back through then and see that the repeatability is responsible for 2.5% of the variance. Reproducibility is 3.2, those add together with some rounding error to get 5.6%, and our product is 99.4%. So you can see this is a small gauge in R&R percent. But how do you interpret the results based on this? And it's going to be based on something that's called the interclass correlation coefficient. The interclass correlation coefficient is simply the percent of total variance that's due to the product variance. And again, all the calculations to calculate these various numbers are given in our help section as well as online in our SPC knowledge base. So the interclass correlation coefficient is 0.9437. So what's this mean? Well, you come down and you take a look at this table that tells you exactly what it means. First of all, here is the interclass correlation coefficient, and this is a range, 0.8 to 1.0. Ours is in between that, so this is in yellow. And this is going to be then the type of monitor is a first class monitor. And what that means is that there's a reduction of a process signal of less than 10%. So our measurement system, when there's an out-of-control point on our product chart, is not going to impact that signal strongly. And also there's a chance of detecting a big shift of 99% with rule 1. And rule 1 is points beyond the control limits. And then this tells us the ability to track process improvements. In this case, we can track process improvements up to a CP of 1.042. And this is based on the specifications that we entered earlier. What that means is if you have process improvements and you get to a point of your CP value is 1.042 and you continue to make improvements, this measurement system is going to go from a first class to a second class monitor. And as that happens, you have more of a reduction in signal, less opportunity to detect major shifts. And eventually you'll get to a point, if you continue to improve your process, to where your measurement system is no longer any good. And that's really a value of about 2.083. So this table then helps you interpret the results, because what you'd like to have, of course, is a first-class monitor. It also gives in the probable error coming out. The probable error is given here, and it's 2.553. This then helps you determine whether or not you have effective measurement increments. So it gives you the smallest effective measurement increment, the largest, and if your measurement increment is not between these two, then you need to add or drop digits so that the measurement system is within the range. Again, this table is reproduced with permission by Dr. Wheeler from his book, Evaluating the Measurement System, EMP3, and the four rules are listed down here. So the summary sheet gives you a lot of information on what the results mean for your measurements. So a lot of information about your measurement system based on this technique of evaluating the measurement system. A couple things I mentioned earlier. One was if you enter a value for the process sigma, perhaps you know your standard deviation from a range chart that you keep on your product in the production unit. What the process will do, or the program will do, is it will use that in place of this total variance down here and calculate the product variance then from that estimate. So that'll help you in case your parts are not really indicative of your process. The other thing is sometimes you have one-sided specifications, and if you include the average with the one-sided specifications, then when the program goes through and calculates these ability to track process improvements, it'll use the CPK value instead of the CP value. This is a way that the program takes a look at how to analyze a gauge R&R study using the methodology we call evaluating the measurement process. Thanks for watching the video.